Blackstone Audio presents The Seascape Tattoo by Larry Niven and Stephen Barnes. This book is read by James Patrick Cronin. To my copious array of cousins and their descendants, Larry Niven. To Fritz Leiber and Robert E. Howard, the dreams you shared were more golden than the treasures your heroes pursued, more magical than the sorcerers they slew. Stephen Barnes. 1. The Taxman. Because their city sprawled out along a desert coastline, Manaheimians always seemed surprised and unprepared when water fell from the sky. They rarely cobbled their side streets and seemed not to know how to control their carts and horses in muddy thoroughfares. Aros's men grumbled in low voices as they struggled through the muck. Near the Happy Mermaid, they gathered in little clumps, then one big clump. Each carried a bulging sack on his back or shoulders, each leaving a weapon hand free. They moved inside, found an empty table in the kitchen, and began dumping what they had. Fat Mal had a goat. Tor One Eye had three kinds of potatoes. Aros the Aztec had brought finger-sized bananas, two great bunches. Carpote, the inn's owner, came down the stairs grinning.
Aros, more free fare for my folk?
Free if you'll serve us drink.
Your first round is free, taxman, and of course my clients will know who to thank.
Aros nodded more or less happily. He'd get no better. It was a good exchange. Taxmen needed friends. Tor had picked them a table, a big one. Aros's dozen men took benches and proceedings for the accounting and dispersal of tax money. Aros, once a thief, had become one of the five major tax collectors in the kingdom of Quilia. He was Azteca by birth. His bloodline had gifted him with swarthy skin, straight black hair, and piercingly direct black eyes. He was a tall, broad man whose size and strength were often underestimated until it was too late to retreat. He was too obtrusive to pick a pocket, but when he scowled, more than one citizen had simply handed him their purse from an instinctive wish to avoid trouble. It was helpful in his new role. He looked around once, as men left off drinking to raid Eros's bananas. They'd know where those came from, and when Carpote baked the potatoes and bell peppers and the goat, they'd know to thank the taxmen. A good bargain. You couldn't always collect coins. Some families had to pay in kind, and Eros's men let them get away with that. He'd seen to it. Aros crouched on one of the Happy Mermaid's rough-hewn benches, rubbing his muddied boots against a table leg. Damn boots were only a week old and already filthy. As he drank, wondering which of several bootmakers might clean his footwear without scalping him, he considered the bawdy conversation between the three rascals sharing his table and strove to conceal his annoyance. In Eros's educated opinion, the role of tax collector was more profitable than outright brigandry had ever been. So long as he and his men turned in the expected minima from each district, they were left pretty much to their own devices. And their devices were endless. But while it would be dishonest to plead total virtue on his own part, his personal code prescribed limits his men often ignored. As a result, he sometimes felt more lion tamer than leader of the pride.
Pretty widows need comforting,
Tor One Eye said in his weasel's voice, continuing his discourse on a woman in the capital's outskirts. He pounded his knife into the table and dragged the point an inch or two, raising a curl of wood.
I say I'm doing a public duty, a kindness, if you please, in exchange for company. I ease her tax burden a coin or two.
The others hooted agreement and seemed ready to begin their own tales of fiscally enabled debauchery. But they kept an eye on Aros, knowing the barbarian disapproved of such things, for reasons they did not entirely understand.
No widows, even if they look like pigs, he said, voice low and hard. What you do with others is your business, but virgins and righteous widows are out of bounds, damn you. Tor glared at him from his one useful orb.
The dice are downright unfriendly these days. I got debts, he said. Some of us can't afford to be so pure and pristine-like.
The others agreed, muttering. They were afraid of Eros, just enough to accept his odd rules. But sufficient greed would overcome caution one day. He knew it. And on that day, they would try him. While his back was turned, of course.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.